what we are talking about when we are talking bridging differences. And in a nutshell, it is about recognizing that and respecting that others have their own needs, values, goals, and worldviews, just like you do. And I know that is hard to do sometimes. So also holding that very firmly. It isn't about persuading others or compromising our own beliefs, values, or identities. It's about fostering understanding and connection across our differences. Bridging requires more than just actions. It involves mindsets, attitudes rooted in openness, acceptance, and respect. The work starts within, truly. And without these mindsets and attitudes, bridging is not possible. It allows us to see another's humanity and, when possible, recognize shared identities and common goals so that we can move towards more positive and more harmonious interactions. So it's not only about seeing another's humanity for the sake of seeing another's humanity. Hopefully, that recognition moves us to action and to progress on shared goals. Bridging differences encourages us to make more people feel seen and like they belong. So it truly does foster belonging. And it also makes us feel like we belong to an even wider community, not just a narrow in-group. So for those of you going, okay, but I can't do this with so-and-so, or this person triggers me too much given my lived experience, there are guidelines that we use as to when to bridge and when to block, or when to bridge or when not to bridge. We can bridge our differences as long as there's openness, acceptance, and respect, and we don't bridge in their absence. So what does this mean? It means that if someone's opposing belief is denying your existence, and if respect isn't present, then you would consider not bridging. You would consider whether you are safe to be in that space. So it's really important that we acknowledge that and that we set that as a ground rule for engagement. So here are the science-based skills for bridging differences that we teach, disseminate through our Bridging Differences program. And they are in these categories: intrapersonal, interpersonal, and inner group. The intrapersonal being things that you do yourself to get yourself ready or to get yourself re-engaged after, during, before difficult conversations or bridging interactions. The interpersonal skills are skills that you would be engaging with others. And today we're going to talk about listening with compassion, and we're going to talk about finding shared identities as two really important skills. And then our inner group section in our Bridging Differences playbook, which is a resource that's available and free to download, also has a section on inner group. That's a section that we're going to be growing in the coming months and years. So I want to talk about what we do in terms of character virtues, which is also something that we're doing more and more in our Bridging Differences program. These are some of the character virtues that we either cultivate as we engage in bridge building, or the character virtues that actually are a byproduct of engaging in some of these interactions. We're going to be talking about the skill of listening with compassion. It goes beyond simply hearing someone's words. It means truly listening with the intent to understand the emotions and perspective, even if their experience is different from your own. We see the practice of compassionate listening as a practice for cultivating curiosity, empathy, and humility. And I'll kind of dissect how curiosity, empathy, and humility show up. So I'll start off with something that we do often when we invite people to listen with compassion, which is an invitation to ask questions to encourage the other person to elaborate on their thoughts or feelings. And this can look something like, can you expand on that? Tell me more. I find this topic really intriguing. Can you please share what led you to this viewpoint? So moving on to this other slide that we typically share when we invite people to listen with compassion, we invite them to ask themselves, why does the speaker feel or think the way they do? Which is empathy, connecting with what they shared, thinking less about how you would feel or think the specific situation, and think more about them. So when we talk about empathy, I want to move on to this quote from Dr. Brené Brown, which I really love, which goes, "We need to dispel the myth that empathy is walking in someone else's shoes." I don't even think that's possible, right? Rather than walking in your shoes, I need to learn how to listen to the story you tell about what it's like in your shoes, and I believe you even if it doesn't match my experiences. Okay, moving on to humility, affirming the feelings and intentions of the speaker. So you could say things like, yes, I hear you, and I understand where you're coming from, or I disagree, but I can see why you would feel the way that you feel. But science, moving on to the science, which is what drives our work, tells us that if we want other people to understand us, we must start by listening closely to them. So when we listen, we increase the chance of people connecting with us. Just by listening, we are also perceived as more trustworthy. We are also more persuasive just by listening. When we listen, it makes our conversation partners less defensive, but it also makes them more open-minded and less focused on their self-interests. So the impact of high quality listening, we know that high quality listening, when we listen to others, it reduces bias and it sparks compassion, self-insight, and openness to change.